that's the best mouth action I ever seen. He meant it was the best action. Big as that. Good thing. He's dead. Yes. It's what? They're the strongest word. Well, it's like saying who's better boxer, you know. Dempsey, Jess Willard, or whoever, you know. At least. Oh, a personal favorite? Yeah, that sounds very funny. I owned a studio, which is a very vigorous place, for about 12 years, and I had a good time there. When I was the boss and I was beset by money problems and stupidly didn't hire somebody to handle that stuff. So, but I didn't like to be my own boss for 12 years. But then I went, some years later, I became the head of Paramount Animation Studio for 2 years. And then I had the most fun I ever had because I had the skills which I developed in my own studio, but I didn't have to worry about money. So I guess that was the best time I had in that kind of animation. Now, if you're asking what is the most important work I think I've done, and the most use of all the skills I have, which are, I think, three, it was on the educational movie. And, you know, Emo and the Kitzel things, which are still here, I guess, on the air, aren't they, on Saturday. These educational movies, I read for 6 months before I made a drawing on the subject. And at least for the, that was a series of 104 movies called The Spirit of 76. And it was about the Revolutionary War. Now, I could have taken many books that I had on the Revolutionary War. I just took the point of view of some author and made, you know, 104 movies. But I didn't want to do that. I do enjoy history, and I had my own attitudes about it. So I read for months, and I finally wrote a series where I had people write with me. A series of movies which, in a way, showed that this war was unnecessary. If King George had come over here and discovered that Americans did not live in wigwams, and he really thought that, you know, with a bunch of uncoaches and checks over here, if he'd come over, he might have been a little more amiable. And if the Americans hadn't gotten so used to stealing from the government and smuggling, you know, some of the most respectable people in the area were like John Hancock, a smuggler. Everybody smuggled. They just paid off the English officials. And, you know. Now it seemed that England was going to get very serious, and the man that everybody had to pay, you know, they just weren't about to do it. So they had a war over those things. So I wrote this whole 104 thing pretty much that way, where I showed that the English had jails that were very harsh, so did the Americans. So I balanced the thing back and forth. And I think we did a very interesting 104 movies. I think it was an example of, on television, it was an example of the advertising agencies getting an idea by the throat, because the live action stuff was putrid, puerile, jerky, stupid. I did make a stipulation when I was going to do this job. I spoke to the man who had to go out and sell it, Marvin Green. He said, "Marvin, no agency man is going to come into my studio. Nobody. they'll see the pictures when they're done. They won't pick out one title or anything. They have nothing to do with me. Just tell them to go and buy the stuff. That's all. So Marvin said, I can't do that. I said, you can do it, Marvin. You're a great salesman. And I know what I would be against. And he said, I'm not sure I can do it. Anyhow, he went to, I'm glad. They said to Marvin, gee, the list of these titles, you know, some of them make sense. We never heard of some of these things. And what are they? So Marvin said, well, these are things we don't have much to do. They said, well, gee, we're going to put up a couple of $1 million and don't know anything about it. No, we want one meeting with this guy. So Marvin said, listen, so I said, oh. So they sent over a nice man about 40-ish and a young woman about, they looked nice. So they came into my office and they sat down and the man said, can you give us an example of, you know, how are you going to do this? So I said, well, I'll give you a good example. There was a man named John Honeyman who lived in New Jersey. Butcher and a Tory, and he used to go to sell his meat in the encampments of the English in New Jersey, and his neighbors hated him, and in fact he was in danger of being shot in the middle of the night, which happens to Tories, or his house burned down, or being shipped off to a jail, but he made no bones about his belief in the king. He was ostracized by all of you because he steadfastly was a Tory. After the war, Washington was on his way down through this area with his retinue. Stopped at John Henryman's front yard and in front of all the neighbors, pinned the medal on John Henryman, who was the greatest spy in the war. Excuse me. So these two people sat there, and I thought it was a great story. No expression. The man looked very puzzled. He finally said, Mr. Culhane, just what is a Tory?
Oh,
I may be jealous. Yes. A business. Well, I did have quite a conversion of business. I had been in the business from 1934. I went into Waltz in 1935, asking for a job. And he said to me, I've been hiring people from New York recently, and I've got terrible habits. My God, they're really awful. And so I decided a better way to do would be to take kids coming right out of school who have no bad habits, don't even know a thing about the business, what can draw, and not have all this headache of bad habits. So no thanks. So I said to him, well, I really want to work here, and I desperately did. I said, I'll go in with these children. And he said, it's $50 a week. And I was making $250. $50. And I said, I'll take it. He said, Jesus. But I began to work there, and I soon found out that, one, I couldn't really draw very well. I hadn't any real education in art, except what I did myself. And I wasn't very good as a teacher, because I had all kinds of tricks that were not acceptable. Now, I had an art school that we had to go one night a week, 3 hours. But it was open every night. So I went every night for 3 hours after 8 hours of work. And began to learn how to draw. But even so, for about a year, year and a half, I got shoved around. I got so that I would barely hang my hat on the hat rack. It really wasn't worthwhile because I'd be out of that room before it settled on the hook, you know. They shunted me all around. One day, Walt came by and asked me how it's going. Usually, he said, fine. This day, I said, lousy. And so he asked why it was so lousy. I said, well, he said, I came here to do animation, and I'm doing a crowd shot here and a story sketch there, and don't seem to have any career in the place. He said, what would you like to do? I said, I like to animate Pluto. And left. So later, I got a call, pick up your things, oh Christ, here we go again. So I had to go to a director named Sharpstein, New York director, who took a dislike to me because I drew with great speed. He had, I think he was born not with a silver spoon, but an eraser. And worked the eraser more than the pencil when he was an animator, so he thought this is how you do. And so he didn't like me at all. So anyhow, I went into his room and he informed me that I was going to be a part of his unit. I was going to work with an animator named Roberts, Bill Roberts, and I was not going to do animation. I was going to fix up the changes that Walt told Roberts to make on his work. And that's all I was going to do, fix up things. Well, I was furious. Going to see Roberts, I had never met him. He's this little wiry man with eyeglasses down like this, you know, and beady eyes looking at everything and not liking what he saw, with a black pipe that stank. So he didn't like this either, tell. So I sat down and he said, here's a, he talked through his nose, he was a mountaineer. He called Mickey Mouse a varmint. So he gave me a shot which was a scene from what picture? I forget the name of the picture. And then it was just Pluto gets ready and he jumps over to the sky. A couple of dozen drawings, that's all. So that couple of dozen drawings I made in about 8 seconds. And put all this stuff together, walked over to Bill and handed it to him, and he was drawing. He took it and he put it in a waste paper basket when I'm drawing. So I went back and I drew some more. This time I took 9 seconds right into the basket. Little by little I got the idea, so I spent a couple of hours and I finally did the animation and it was acceptable. And for 6 months, every time I did something, it was sent up to Walt to look at it with a pencil reel, and Roberts would come back and he never said it was good or bad or indifferent, just gave me another shot. 6 months of this and I didn't know where the hell I was. I should have been a little more astute, seeing that I didn't have to make things over. I fixed up whatever. But he had a habit of getting involved with drawing Pluto, and as he drew, he got more and more interested, and the legs got shorter until Pluto looked like a chihuahua. And it was my job to take the chihuahua and add the legs in, so I had to move the body. So I had to do things like that, and I never realized, this is a very good way to learn how to not draw chihuahuas, but Pluto. So finally, I got a blow. Bill came in one day and he said, "Gene, I'm going to work on Snow White. You ain't." Back to the salt mines, But what happened is that he said, "Better see Sharpstein." So I went in, and Sharpstein had this huge sequence on the wall, drawing after drawing of Pluto and a crab. Very complicated looking thing. And so the very first animation I did, except for crowd shots at Walt's, was this about 3 minutes of Pluto and a crab, and it was highly successful. But, it was funny, wasn't it? Yeah. So that was the very first animation. Good. Yeah, why not? From then on, I became a Pluto specialist, one of three in the studio. Because most people couldn't handle the kind of acting that they could do. So I had fun doing it. Well, pardon? Oh yes, yes, I've got myself a beauty. Everyone else is having these great shots, a lot of action and everything. Sharpstein stiffed me with this job where all seven dwarfs marched. And they marched uphill, downhill, backwards, and behind waterfalls. That was my stint. It took me 6 months with two assistants and one in between it to do Hi-Ho. Each shot, I had to take seven dwarfs. Each one had his own way of walking. I had to take seven dwarfs, separate pieces of paper, talk about perspective. I had to work out the perspective. Every dwarf, if you went down like so, that had to be figured out. Because Walt didn't want them to walk up each other's back or make spaces between them. They had to walk rank. So that before I made a drawing, I got into this perspective joke. And I hate perspective. So nothing but do it. Oh, I must say something else. I worked in the studio for 2.5 years after that, I never had to make a change of anything. I was so scared. I never sent anything into the reel, you know, for Walt to look at that I didn't sweat over it, make it as perfect as I could. So I never had the changing going the whole time I was there. The only time I changed things when they added stuff. Like in this picture, they had done the crab just like a prop, you know? He hung on a tail or something. But I began to think something missing here. This guy is a little tough guy, and I thought to myself, suppose it was like Eddie G. Robinson, you know, what would he do? And so immediately I saw the top of the shell as a derby, so, you know, so I was like, so I did a little piece like that, and every time they ran a reel, they had some of the writers come in. When they saw this, they began to write a lot more, so that probably expanded over half a minute more of animation, just because I had this idea. So I enjoyed my business, but I was very scared. Everybody was. If you went in there, Walt would be looking at something, and he'd sit there grabbing at the arm of your chair, waiting for him to see something. Everybody was scared. He was the type of...
Did anyone ever get on his bad side?
On a what?
On his bad side, Walt's bad side.
What do you mean? No.
Is everyone scared? Did they have a reason to be scared?
You're damn right. If you hit a certain level of work, Walt remembers everybody's work. And if you had done, you know, like, if I had done a Pluto like that, but it was good. My next job, I didn't do a good Pluto. Out. Really out. No Pluto, man. So that there was the mortality was high, really. So it was right to be very scared of war. However, here's this man who, incidentally, no one ever had a job in the studio like that, particularly when I had with Bill Roberts. It cured this business of knocking drawings off, you know. I got to be meticulous. And it changed me forever, because no matter what I'm doing now, you know, I wrote a book, and it took me a while to get into the thing, and I would write pages, pages over it. 5 times, 6 times, 12 times, the whole stack, you know, throw them away. Because I realized at Walt's, through this whole experience, the waste paper basket is your friend. You think it isn't? It protects you. It does. It protects you. You keep throwing it away and your reputation. So it is a protection. It is not a defeat. So I can write 20 times over if I need to until I like it. And the 19th time was no defeat. It's just a way of getting to the ultimate. So we got that instilled in us. And believe me, we went out into the rest of the animation world like zealots. Yeah. I got sick. I'll make this very short. I had a ulcerated jaw, which didn't hurt me. And I had a dentist who didn't like x-rays. I never had any cavities, so I would get a perfunctory examination and come back in a year. In the meantime, I had this thing eating into my jaw. And it gave me such a neuritis that the box of the cat I do with my arm in a sling, like this. And when I got finished, I couldn't put on a coat because I couldn't move my arm. I finally gave it up. But what was happening is I got sick every afternoon. It's because out in Hollywood, there's a big drop in the from hot to cold, you know. So in that time when the weather was changing, I would get this colitis. Incredible pain. So my MD, he thought I had something else, limited dream, because it didn't hurt my joints. So I finally went to walk, I was going to leave. Walt said, hey, the trouble with you goddamn animators, you don't get any exercise. You go to the Hollywood Athletic Club and you tell them, put me on my bill, and you do some wrestling. Well, I used to be a wrestler, so I thought, okay, I'll try it. And so I would try it, and so pretty soon I was 2 weeks in bed. I came to walk and said, this won't do. They said, okay, you probably got one of the lousy goddamn hot doctors. I got a doctor who's a genius. So he sent me to this doctor who I think was a quack. Maybe he wasn't. Anyhow, he gave me pills for nothing. So I finally went out to walk and I said, I have to quit and I have to go east where the weather is changeable. That's what they tell me. If I don't do it, I'll die in 6 months. That's what they said. From exhaustion. Walt said, crap. He didn't really say crap, but he said, pretty good crap. I have big plans for you. My God, you know, I never saw somebody improve so fast. There's no limit to what you might do. You're going to do that dog and Nana, you know, you're going to do the whole thing. I said, well, I can't do it. So he got up, went over, and started to read some stuff on his desk. So I got ready to leave and said goodbye to lunch. A week later, I went up to Walt's office and the secretary said, Walt didn't want to see you. So I didn't say goodbye to Walt, I never saw him again. So he can be a mean son of a bitch. He can also be very stupid about what's wrong with him. Amazing man. He put people in jobs here and there that didn't look like sense of it, but it always was. Amazing. Oh, yeah, I was in Miami, you know, and I hated the way it was. It was such a, it was just all the wrong stuff, and it was much worse that second time around because I had all this education and no place to put it. Well, I had a place to put it, but I didn't want it. So I decided at the end of my 2 year stint there, I wanted a sabbatical because I'd been working years without a vacation. And so I thought, let me try for Guggenheim, you know, and see if they give me a year's money so I can do some experimental growing on animals. So I wrote to the people and they sent me a form and I needed two sponsors. So I wrote to Don Graham, who was in charge of the art school at Walt Disney's, and a good friend of mine. And I knew Gene Shiloh, the Mexican artist. And I said, do you think you and Gene Shiloh could be my sponsors? And Don said, no, Walt should be your sponsor. And I thought, what a ridiculous idea for Walt. He didn't want to even say goodbye. So he wrote and said, well, I'll try Walt. Well, I got a copy of this memo, and it was the most glowing memo. He's an inexplicable man. Marvelous memo about how ambitious I was and good at what I was doing and so forth. You'd never think you ever was bad at it. It's kind of interesting. So that when I read about, you know, very often the writer will take a point of view about Walt and write a whole article. You can't take one point of view about Walt. He was so multi-pointed. you'd have to go around them like a merry-go-round. He did one thing nicely, then he was somewhere else. He was stingy with money, and he would give enemies $1,000 movie over the movies that they were using. So how can you take a quick view about something like that? And say, for example, he was vulgar, but now he had certain problems about backsides, you know. Fine, but here's a man who spent $100,000 a year, technically fine, but now it's real money, in teaching. We went to school one day a week, we didn't work. We went to art school one day a week. All the bums like me. $100,000 he spent. Now, nobody else in the whole industry spent 5 cents. Literally, not 5 cents. They wouldn't teach anybody anything. So, or not learning at all. But Ward was so determined to have the finest artists in the world in this place, $100,000 was nothing. And the other thing is he'd give you a bonus. If the work you did in the movie was good, it was $10 a foot. If it was pretty good, it was $8. If it was fair, I'd give you $6. This is in addition to your salary. So that I was working from that $50, I got up to about